optimistic thinkers have better outcomes. We know this from not just Stephany saying it, not just the Master Resilience Training, but research suggests that if you're an optimistic thinker versus a pessimistic thinker, you're going to have better outcomes.
You are listening to Coach Carlisle's Pursuit of Excellence podcast, brought to you by Carlisle Performance Systems, located in San Jose, California. Episode number 14, titled Key Strategies to Bounce Back from Adverse Situations with Dr. Stephany Coakley. Dr. Stephany Coakley is currently the Senior Associate Athletic Director for Mental Health, Wellness, and Performance at Temple University. In addition to that, she served as a military performance expert and resilience trainer. She also is the founder of Maximum Mental Training Associates, a consulting firm working with various organizations and helping them to develop mental resiliency strategies when faced with adversity. And on that note, she's going to share her key strategies to overcome any situation. She likes the term bounce back to describe how one must overcome adverse situations by becoming self-aware, practicing gratitude, and a host of other strategies that she unpacks that, again, you can use and implement into your daily life. As I always mention, I love your feedback, so come on over to my Instagram at Coach Dwayne Carlisle or my Facebook page and leave a note. I would love to hear from you, and I'd love to stay in touch. Now on to the show. Welcome to the show, Stephany. How are you doing?
I'm great, Dwayne. Thanks for having me. Really glad to be here.
Well, thanks for being a part of it. We got a really exciting topic, one that is an emerging topic. I think it's something that people have always had to deal with, no doubt, in any endeavor in life. However, there's a lot of awareness being brought to this topic of mental resiliency. Doc, can you tell us a little bit about what mental resiliency is?
Mental resilience is more its ability, a skill that people have. And we know that they have this skill because they're able to bounce back from adversity. We all have adversity. Nobody's immune to it. And there are some people who, when they experience adversity, a car accident, the loss of a loved one, a sexual assault, there are some people when they experience those adversities, there is no bounce back. The adversity serves to diminish who they are or who they were. And others who have mental resilience are able to work through and deal with the after effects of their adversity and bounce back to the person that they were. It doesn't happen automatically. It doesn't happen overnight. But they have the ability. And we don't know how. For some people, they develop it across their lifespan. For others, I spent the last 9 years training soldiers how to develop the mental and emotional tools to address and deal with adverse events. So some have it and others can be taught.
Now, let's take a step back. You just mentioned you spent 9 years training military soldiers to be able to overcome adversity. What type of training did you have to partake in order to be able to develop that skill yourself to train others to be able to bounce back and overcome adversity?
Sure, that's a good question. I was fortunate to be able to be a part of this program with the Army that was founded in about 2009 called the Master Resilience Training. And that was a 2-week program. I was a student. I had to learn the skills first before I could train the skills. We use a train-the-trainer model. So I was a student first at the University of Pennsylvania, two-week training where we learned the competencies and skills associated with the concept of resilience, which is the ability to grow and thrive in the face of an adverse event. Well, so in that training, we learned that, you know, from research, or there's research to support that there are six competencies associated with a resilient person. And these competencies are self-awareness, self-regulation, strength of character, optimism, mental agility, and connection. So those are the six competencies associated with resilience. And then we also learned, under the umbrella of each of those competencies, skills associated with building optimism, or skills associated with self-awareness. And so we learned 14 skills, six competencies, 14 skills. And then after I learned them, I had to kind of practice them and train them myself before I was able to then go out and teach soldiers how to develop those competencies and skills so that they would be better prepared to deal with, manage adverse events in their lives. So I had to go to Penn, and 2 weeks of training, it was great. 2 weeks of training, about 150 of us, soldiers and civilians, mostly soldiers. But it was a great opportunity to learn and grow as a professional.
When we think of mental resiliency, and one of the reasons why I wanted to bring you onto the show is because I had the personal opportunity to work with you for one of my NFL events. So I saw you in action. And I love the model that you created. And I love the information that you were sharing with the people who attended the event. And if you could just give us a sense, because adversity is everywhere, right? And people encounter adversity and have to be mentally resilient in most situations. What are some of the common strategies that you use in order to help somebody overcome adversity?
Okay. So my main strategy that I use, and I've been using this for more than, I guess, probably about 13 to 15 years. I learned when I was in graduate school back in 2004 or so that optimistic thinkers, people who are more optimistic, they have better outcomes, regardless of whether they've had a great life, a smooth life, and everybody's going to experience adversity. So even if your life has been mostly smooth, you've had some adverse events. Optimistic thinkers have better outcomes. We know this from not just Stephany saying it, not just the Master Resilience Training, but research suggests that if you're an optimistic thinker versus a pessimistic thinker, you're going to have better outcomes. And so one of the tools that I started using early on with soldiers, that when I worked with them, I would ask them, you know, and I worked at Walter Reed Military Medical Center, and which was a place where soldiers had experienced, if they were there, 9 times out of 10, they had experienced an adverse event, because that's the medical hospital where soldiers are returning from a combat situations or combat scenarios, and they've incurred an injury or have been wounded. So they were definitely people who had experienced adverse events. So when I would work with them, amongst many of the other tools and strategies I helped them to develop, I would ask them, what's good? Like, I know that there's a whole lot of bad going on, but let's turn our focus just for 2, 3, 4, 5 minutes to what's good. And I started this kind of practice. I called it practicing gratitude. So practicing gratitude is one of my signature kind of skills. And in the Army's program, they call it hunt the good stuff. But essentially, it's the same thing. Your grandmother probably used to help you to practice gratitude, or somebody you know from Sunday school or church. And it's essentially counting your blessings. What are you grateful for? Because oftentimes when people are expressing gratitude, that's a positive emotion rather than some of the negative emotions that we express when we're being pessimistic. So when you're in a positive emotion state, if you will, you have better performances, you feel better, your mind is open, it's the ability to be more creative and problem solving is greater. So just by doing that simple strategy, practicing gratitude, three things every day, what are you grateful for and why are you grateful for these things? Or why are you appreciative of these things? That's just kind of one key strategy right there.
I love that. Just acknowledging what you're grateful for and having that positive emotional state. What are some other things that people can do and other strategies that you've seen that have worked to help people overcome adverse situations?
So another one of the strategies is kind of like, how do you interpret the things that happen to you? So oftentimes, like I'm working right now with a lot of student athletes, young people, young adults, and late teenagers. And it's really about how they interpret when something bad happens to them. How do they interpret things? Is it all their fault? Or is it all somebody else's fault? Is it that when something bad happens to them, are they going to continuously have bad things happen to them? So trying to help them become more self-aware, right, of their thinking patterns. Like, how are you, like, is everything somebody else's fault? So help them to break down, like, okay, well, if I were to, one of the questions I ask them is like, well, if I were to follow you with a video camera, what would I see? Help them to be more accurate in how they describe things, because there's no all or nothing. There's not, it's everybody. It's not always you. So helping them to be more accurate in their interpretations or accurate in their appraisals of things that happen to them. Because if it's always somebody else, or if it's always them, the adverse event that occurs, that's just how they're going to interpret it. And if you interpret things like it's always somebody else, then you don't have any control. So helping them to gain, like, first of all, this awareness of, like, how do you think generally? And helping them to understand that it's important to be more accurate in your appraisals of everyday events and adverse events, because that's gonna be important in how you deal with an adverse event, your appraisal or your interpretation of the event.
Okay, Doc.
Does that make sense?
Sure. Let's take this scenario. I love that you dialed into working with student athletes. And oftentimes, it's just been in my little experience working with them, they're always looking away, right? They're always looking at how other people might have affected them, opposed to looking at themselves. Mm-hmm. And people do that in the workplace as well. So
yes.
Let's say you have walked them through the ability to look at situations and kind of disconnect, but detach themselves from it. And they're just actually looking
at it. Yeah, that's good.
Okay, for what it is, they've done that. What would the next step be to help them? And they're still suffering from some adversity. What would the next step be?
So then you start asking yourself some questions. Maybe if they're a person who has a tendency to blame others, then might ask them, well, what was it? How did I contribute to the situation? Or if they have a tendency to blame themselves, it's always their fault. It's always something that they did that caused, you know, something bad to happen in their life. Ask the question, how could others have been involved? Once again, help them to be more accurate in how they see the world, because the thing about it is, if you have a tendency to just always think in a certain way, when the good stuff happens to you, you're going to think that way, and it mightn't be problematic when the good stuff happens, but it's it can definitely be problematic when the negative events happen in your life.
Okay.
So helping them to just break it down, ask some questions. How was I involved? If they have a tendency to always blame others, and be the it's kind of like a victim mentality. Or how could others have been involved if it's kind of like them always blaming themselves?
Okay.
There are other types of thinking patterns that people can get in. They can get into the pattern where I've noticed a lot of this lately, where when something unpleasant happens to them, they assume that they try to project what the other person's thinking.
Athletes and coaches do that a lot.
Yes, I know. So yeah. Just helping them. One of the things I do with athletes in my office, because they'll come in and they'll say, coach did X, Y, and Z. I know that's what he or she was thinking. And I'll say, well, how do you know that? And they'll give me some rationale. And I'll say to them, well, okay, seems like you're really great at being able to know what somebody else is thinking. So what am I thinking right now?
Mind readers.
Now, nine times out of 10, they'll say, I don't know. And I'll say, exactly. Which is kind of like, it's a little bit like they get it. Oh, so I don't know what she's thinking. How could I really know what somebody else is thinking? And then once again, once they realize that they don't have this ability, then the next step is to get the information. Because more often than not, they're not, and I always say, like, you don't know what I'm thinking. I could be thinking, like, what's for lunch? Or my back hurts or my head hurts. So ask the questions before making assumptions and thinking you know what your coach or you know what your teammates are doing or why they did a certain thing.
Yeah, I think that's really important.
So it's huge, like, because that cuts down a lot of, once again, of the negative, the way you feel about yourself if you think that somebody's like out to get you. And everything that you think that they're doing is, against you. I had somebody I talked to this week, and I asked her the question, what do you think I'm thinking about? And she was one of the people who actually had an answer for me. And her answer gave me some insight into just kind of like her patterns. And she said, I think you're thinking that my problems, I'm making a big deal out of this. And I was like, nope, that's not what I was thinking at all. So once again, it showed her that, like, you could be wrong about what you're projecting onto other people. And that also gave me insight to know that she has a pattern of thinking, like, something's wrong with me, like, I'm the problem.
Doc, I think that happens in business. I think it happens in life. I think it happens in relationships where people,
yes,
oftentimes are mind reading. My wife tells me I have a tendency to do that. It happens with coaches, and I'm not just trying to bring other people into my equation. We as coaches oftentimes will kind of mind read. We're always thinking about what somebody's thinking based on maybe their actions or what have you. And I love the strategy. It just starts with just a simple question and approaching somebody and asking them. Ask the question.
Get the information.
That question is? Give me 2 to 3 questions that you would ask.
So it depends on the scenario.
Okay.
So for example, let's just say you and your teammates practice is over and you, it's time to go back to the house, to housing, to the dorm. And you look up and they've gone and they've left you. So your thought is, they don't want to be with me. Or they knew that I wanted to go with them. The answer to why they left early and left you could be, tens of hundreds. So when you see them again, you could just ask the question, hey, like, I wanted to go grab dinner with you guys, or I wanted to, Did you all know that? Oh, no, we didn't know. Answer the question. So now it's not they did something to me. They just did something. And there was no intent associated with it. What? Or maybe you learned that I had to get back because I had, you know, a group of us had to meet with our classmates to do a project. It's, you know, that time of the year. So we couldn't, you know, linger and wait. We had to meet somebody. So just once again, communication is very important as well. That's another strategy, communication and connection with other people and a resilient strategy. So like the more resilient people, they are not the people who kind of are lone, you know, individuals and don't have a strong sense of connection to at least one or two people.
Tie that into how that helps to contribute to them becoming more mentally resilient by not projecting into something, but asking somebody questions when they're confronted with situations. In other words, they're not trying to be mind readers. How does that help them become more mentally resilient?
Well, it just helps in the way that they, because when they are doing the mind reading, et cetera, it causes a lot of negative emotions. It causes, and when we have all those negative emotions, our ability to problem solve and to think through, you know, difficult situations is reduced. So it helps them to, A, not experience those negative emotions, because instead of getting anxious because they felt somebody was doing something to them, or getting sad or becoming sad and depressed because they feel that everything's their fault, they can just ask a question. Hey, I sent you a text message. Let's just say this is a romantic relationship, a husband and a wife. I sent you a text message, and what happened? I didn't hear from you. Instead of becoming angry or sad about that, oh, my phone was dead, or I was in a meeting. So now you are not likely to do anything that is going to cause further. Because right now we don't actually have an issue or a problem. We just have a situation. Somebody didn't respond to a text message.
Right, right.
But if you ask the right questions, it doesn't turn into something more serious.
All right, Doc, here we go. I just had a game. Mm-hmm. And I didn't perform well, or I may have had a job interview. And mm-hmm. I didn't necessarily feel good about the interview. And now maybe I've created an adverse situation, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And I just, man, I got this cascade of emotions where I just didn't feel good about it. Give me some strategies to help me come out of that and overcome it.
Take a deep breath. So first of all, a lot of times when we are kind of having this cascade of emotions, our body is doing something that is unpleasant. So whether it's tension, or whether our breathing is, you know, more rapid, or our heart rate is increasing, or maybe we're sweating, our body's doing something when we have this cascade of usually negative emotions. So I would recommend take a deep breath. Even maybe the job interview is over, before you go to your next thing, take a 5-minute walk. On that 5-minute walk, start to practice gratitude. I know that. So what are 3 things that are good in my life? Because whether I got that job or not, I'm still Stephany. I'm still employed, right? So I still have a job. So that's a great thing. I'm not looking for a job and don't have a job. So that's something to be grateful for. I have my health. That's something to be grateful for. And, you know, later today, I'm going to the Sixers game. So these are 3 things. So basically, I just changed my mood. And because your brain can't focus on 2 things at the same time. So I just changed my thoughts to something that was more positive, created some positive emotion. And now, maybe I can think a little bit more broadly about the interview. Well, when I get back to the to my desk, or when I get back home, I'm going to write a thank you, you know, write my thank you note, and maybe try to do something in the thank you note that gives them a window into who I am as a person and why they should hire me. Because it's not over, right? The interview part is over, but I still have this part that I could use to help myself. When you are in a very shut down place, like when you are, you know, like that cascade of emotions is on board, it's hard for you to even get to a place where you're problem solving. So I would say, take a deep breath, take a walk, change your, you know, change what you're thinking about, and then try to problem solve. That's just kind of one way you could approach that situation.
Okay, let's go here with it. After an athletic event, maybe I missed a free throw that could have sent the game into overtime, or I dropped the ball, or I had a chance to score a goal as a lacrosse player. Mm-hmm. I missed the net.
Mm-hmm.
How do you deal with that?
Okay. So once again, how are you appraising the situation? So it sounds like you're appraising the situation as, it's my fault that we lost the game. Is that correct? Let me just see once again, asking questions.
Sure.
Is that correct, Coach? Okay.
Yeah, that's
correct. So then I would say, well, were you out there alone? Who else might have contributed to the fact that the team did not win today's game? Or what other circumstances might have contributed to the fact that today's game was not won by our team? Oh, so now let's answer these questions. Our two top scorers were out. One had a penalty, one had an injury. You know, I almost scored the last goal, and it would have gone in except for, like, you know, it hit the crossbar and it just bounced out. What are some other, so just ask yourself some circumstances, some other questions, like what other people or what other circumstances led to this outcome, because you're not the only person on the field at that time.
Now, let me ask you this. All right.
Mm-hmm.
First off, let's say I'm going through this process of writing down these questions, and
mm-hmm.
I recall that, guess what? Jimmy missed a goal too. Is that something
I should
beat my chest about? Or like, how do
not
you,
beating
how do you,
your chest about.
Okay.
It's not beating your chest about, but you have to be more accurate, because guess what? If you believe that, you know, athletes, if they believe that it's their free shot that caused them to win the game, lose the game, or them missing a goal that caused them to lose the game, that is going to cause what? A whole bunch of, I don't know, what are some disappointment, maybe depression, sadness.
Sure.
A lot of negative emotions. Those negative emotions aren't generally helpful. So you have to help people to learn skills and strategies that are going to help them overcome challenging situations, because that's what we're talking about, right? Helping them overcome challenging situations. And the way we do that is through a whole bunch of cognitive, the way you think about things, and self-regulatory, how you respond to things, processes.
Yeah, I love that.
So yeah,
I love that.
It is good to pay attention to all the other circumstances, because it's not just you.
Okay, Doc. So you just mentioned
yes.
How you respond, and earlier you mentioned mm-hmm. the word bounce back. Now, I've had the opportunity to work with thousands and thousands of athletes, and many of them haven't had someone with your expertise yet. Some of them have demonstrated this uncanny ability to bounce back from situations
mm-hmm.
because of the way they respond. Can you say something about that? Is that something that some people do naturally, or what have you seen?
Well, I think that it's hard to parse out whether some people are just kind of born more resilient, but there are definitely some people in this life who experienced a lot of adversity from a very, very, very young age.
Right.
And I've had to practice these strategies or practice being optimistic or, you know, practice like when I have a bad situation or an adverse event happen to me, I don't just say to myself, I go and I seek out people for support, that connection, because it's, and then in doing so, I don't feel like so alone or helpless because of the adverse event. So some kids, some young people have just had opportunities to develop these skills. And by the time they are teenagers, by the time they're young adults, they've had some practice with the bounce back.
Yeah. Now, in the scouting world mm-hmm. of sports, let's say NFL scouts, mm-hmm. you get them in a room. And if you ask them to a person, hey, what are some of the things that you're looking for with the particular people that you want to draft or you want on your team? And inevitably, they'll say, we like people that have been through some hardship, and we like people that have been through some tough circumstances, and because it just demonstrates that they're more resilient and they can do this and that and they can bounce back and respond. Do you think there's truth to that? Because to me, it's all right.
Once again, some people respond to adversity by using and abusing substances. Is that, you know, is that what we're looking for? So it just depends on how they're responding. Are they responding in ways that are helpful? So for example, let's just say you're an NFL scout and you have a player who had a pretty significant season-ending injury a couple years ago, and they responded well. Well, what is well? So they came back and were dominant the next year. Okay, so that's one piece to the puzzle. But what did they do in between? Did they set goals, or did they like self-medicate? Did they go and talk to a counselor or a trusted person to get some support while they were going through their recovery and rehab? Or did they, have a lot of promiscuous relationships? So it's like, how are you responding to the adverse event? Because just because he showed up on the field really dominant the next year doesn't mean that he or she is resilient.
Gotcha. All right, Doc, one of the things I've witnessed firsthand was you putting together a mental preparation strategy. If I were to go into a job interview or prior to a game, do you have some suggestions? Mm-hmm. Strategies that I could do to help dial in and get mentally prepared for that upcoming event?
The answer is yes. Okay. But I guess once again, I'd have to know, what are your particular challenges? Is your challenge anxiety, or is your challenge confidence? Is your challenge controlling your emotions? What's your particular challenge? Let's just say your challenge is remaining confident while coming off the bench. Or something like that. Let's just say that's your challenge. So we all know that confidence, or maybe we don't all know this, but confidence is a result of the way you think, right? So your thoughts drive outcomes. So one of the things I do with student athletes who are struggling in the realm of confidence is I help them to establish what I call impact statements. So they'll have like a list of statements that they dial up. Let's just say you're sitting on a bench, and instead of letting your mind wander aimlessly onto random topics or wander aimlessly onto what if I'm not good enough? What if coach, what if I make a mistake and coach takes me out? Once again, none of that's helpful. We have them deliberately and intentionally set what their mind is on. So an impact statement could be something like, I can and I will. I'll bloom where I'm planted. Like these are some, a couple of years ago, I worked with a young high school basketball player, and hers was, If you want to shine like a diamond, you have to be cut like a diamond. And that was her impact statement that she used when she went to the gym, because she hated going to the gym. You know, a lot of athletes want to play. They don't necessarily love practice, and they don't necessarily love lifting weights. But those are the things that are required in order for an athlete to be consistently at their peak. So as a matter of fact, last week I helped an athlete who doesn't really like practice that much to create an impact statement. And his impact statement was, practice is the prerequisite of peak performance.
You sure that wasn't Allen Iverson? Practice. No. Talk about practice.
No, it wasn't AI, but I often use AI to talk about this concept, because the way you play in a game it's directly related to your practice. So if you are messing around in practice, if you're not giving 100% in practice, you know, chances are there's a likelihood that that could manifest itself in a performance, in a game time situation.
You know what?
So practice is the prerequisite of peak performance. And that is what, when he goes to practice where he likes to, he's not as motivated in practice as he is in a game, but that's where you have to be really motivated. That's all he's thinking. Practice is the prerequisite to peak performance.
I'm going to tell you something, Doc.
Yeah.
I am going to call my son right now and ask him to come up with an impact statement, because I have a son that's playing basketball at San Jose State. Started off the year.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Playing a lot of minutes, and now he's not playing as much. And I know firsthand his mind is wandering. But who knows where the mind's going as he's sitting there. Because as you said, he wants to play. Athletes want to play. Everybody wants to play.
They all want to play.
Nobody wants to sit on the bench. And if they're a competitor, it grates them. And so
yes.
Let's talk about this. We're going to close with this impact statement. I think that's something that people can just use and put their arms around when they're going through situations. How do you develop your impact statement? Are there multiple impact statements? Do you take that? When do you use your impact statement? Talk to me. I love this.
Oh, yeah. So your impact statements. Okay. So I can't make them for people. I just give them suggestions and help them put something together. So there are some like best practices for these impact statements. You want it to be powerful. So if you want to shine like a diamond, you got to be cut like a diamond. Like, that is powerful. And it also creates a strong image. So powerful should be present tense. So I can and I will, not I'm going to be great. I am great. Muhammad Ali started saying, I am the greatest, when he was a teenager. He was not the greatest anything, but that was what he was training his mind to be, how he was training his mind to be, which thoughts control, you know, drive consequences, or thoughts drive outcomes. If that's what you're thinking, you're going to do things that are going to enable the outcomes you're looking for. If you think you're the greatest, you're going to work hard. You're going to make sacrifices. That's just kind of like how that works. So it's got to be present tense. It should be purposeful. So like the one I talked about, the basketball student athlete who's a basketball player, hers was purposeful for the gym. The one that I gave, that we talked about with the other student athlete, his was purposeful for practice. So if you can make it purposeful, so especially for the areas where you struggle, so like if you're on the bench, maybe, you know, every second counts. So if you get in there for 60 seconds, ball out for 60 seconds.
Okay.
So make it purposeful. It's present tense, powerful. It should be about the person. So if you can make, you know, somehow put your name in there. One of my impact statements is, things don't just happen, I make them happen. And so when I want it to be even just a little stronger, I say, things don't just happen, I make them happen. Stephany, and then I toss my name in there. Stephany, you make them happen. So that makes it just a little bit stronger, so it's personal. And so those are some best practices. And then, you know, there's some lyrics or, you know, depending on who you are, I've worked with a number of athletes who prayer and scripture can be an impact statement. Basically, what you want to have is a thought that's going to be helpful in that moment when you need it.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what you want.
I need mine right now. I like it. I like it. I want to thank you for being on the show today. You've given us a lot of nuggets. I think that's some great, useful information that people can impart in their lives. Starts with being grateful when you're going through negative.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just being grateful, right? Telling
yourself. You know what, Dwayne? I have a thing in my office. It says, a poster, and it says, every day may not be great, but there's something great in every day.
Man, I love it.
So just remember, if we could just remember that, there's always something, even in the adverse events, and this is like practicing gratitude at the doctorate level, when something terrible happens.
Yeah.
Being able to, you know, when you lose a loved one, being able to pull something out of that might make you feel grateful. So you were able to spend, you know, time with that person before they passed away. If that's something that you can pull from that, it'll be more beneficial to you in terms of your ability to be more resilient in adverse situations.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. And I love the impact statements. I love everything you said. The impact statements is something I can take and I can work on right now and put together, not just for myself. I'm calling my boy. And I'm going to help him to establish an impact statement. As you said, thoughts drive your outcome. I would like to say, how can someone wants to get in touch with you, how can they reach you?
Oh, sure. They can go to the website at www.maximummentaltraining.com. And that's MAXIMUMENTAL. So there's only one M between maximum and mental. MaximumMentalTraining.com. And follow me on Twitter. I'm not often on Twitter, but I'm at B, the letter B, a force of nature. And you can also contact me by sending me an email on my website. So there are, you know, a number of ways that folks can get in touch with me. But just imagine if you were a business professional and you were getting ready to give the presentation of your life and you walked in there with your impact statement and that's what you were thinking about. Not, you know, you're not thinking about what if I bomb this, because that's not helpful. You're thinking about I can and I will. Or I was made for greatness. You walk in there with that mindset, with that thought on board, you will probably crush your presentation.
Let's go. Well, Doc, thank you so much for being on today. I wish you the best at Temple.
You're welcome, Glenn.
At Temple University in your new position back at your alma mater. I know that's going to be exciting for you. So again, thank you very much. And I look forward
to
connecting with you down the road.
And you know what? I'm very grateful for you. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. And I always express my gratitude whenever I have an opportunity. The opportunity at Temple, I'm grateful for it. And I'm grateful for this opportunity this morning. So thank you.
Great stuff from Dr. Coakley. Identify your challenge, whatever it might be, and attack it. Attack it. Come up with a game plan. She talked about confidence is the result of the way you think. Your thoughts drive confidence. It sounds like to me, she talked a lot about the battle being in your mind. It's me versus me. And one of the things that she mentioned, one of the strategies I thought was outstanding, is creating an impact statement, which is a deliberate and intentional statement that you set your mind to when you begin to go through negative situations or you allow negative thoughts to enter into your mind. She gave the example of one of her players who does not like to practice. His impact statement was. Practice is a prerequisite of peak performance, and therefore, he recited it to himself over and over and over and over again until ultimately, he became confident and his thoughts shifted from being negative to positive. Great stuff, Dr. Coakley. We appreciate you and thank you for being on the show. And I want to thank you for listening. Again, I love your feedback. Come on over to Instagram, Facebook. Please subscribe to the show. Rate the show. It would mean the world to us. Thank you very much. And in the meantime, in between time, have a blessed day.